So much of our contemporary culture is premised on the idea that the only true knowledge is knowledge that can be quantified, that can be measured, that can be analyzed, that can be broken down into parts.
And if that's the case, it means that many of the things which matter to us most as human, the world of beauty, aesthetics, the world of value, ethics, these are all merely subjective.
And what we do in this seminar is really interrogate that assumption.
My name is RJ Snell. I'm a philosopher by training.
My name is Mark Gottlieb, and I co-teach the course on the nature of reason in Jewish and Western perspectives.
But then the young boy runs away and Socrates turns to his friends after this young boy has given the right answer and says, yeah, he doesn't know. Because he doesn't yet have an account. He's given the answer, but he hasn't tied down the answer with an account.
He really wanted us to come from this perspective of understanding the challenge of knowing and how we know what we know, defining what objective truth is.
Probably the central text around which we've organized the conversation is René Descartes' Discourse on Method. Descartes, more than anyone, spells out very clear methodological concerns to only believe those things which can be proven beyond any doubt. One of the properties you have is SAR student, yes? Time two, you graduate. You walk down, they give you whatever they give you, right? You are now no longer Maya, because you are no longer an SAR student. Are you an aggregate of your properties, or is there a you who has properties? See the difference of the questions?
Yes. More so than other classroom experiences that I've had, the teacher is very willing to continue to question and go deep into what you're saying and try to figure out what are your motivations for saying that.
The texts animate the questions, actually taking the ideas from the text and letting them play out in real time in the seminar room.
Every single one of us, his question, his point, recognizes ourself, deals with ourself, and does not recognize ourselves especially well. Why do you know yourself so little?
It has to be like a different, like I empirically know Jupiter, I cannot empirically know myself.
Why not just conclude you don't know yourself? Doing great, keep going. He's doing wonderfully, right? He's asking the same questions you're asking.
The pedagogical commitment that I have is to play the Socratic role, to push the interlocutor to follow through the implications of their own position so as to understand the fundamental commitments behind them.
All right, now let's think of a political issue which matters. Immigration. Who of you in the room are for justice? Okay, so we know what to do about the immigration debate. We should be just. No, we're going to be just.
Yeah, so what does that mean you're going to do?
Well, it means we're going to close the borders. Some of you went, no. How many of you sort of like physically recoiled a little bit because you thought, that's not where you're going. You said you were for justice.
For me, it's meant that whenever I say something in class, I have to make sure that I have my reasons for saying it and my evidence to support it.
In other words, the thin abstractions don't tell us very much about what to do, right?
When the students kind of have that aha moment where they realize, okay, I have to take these arguments seriously, but there's another path forward. That's a precious moment.
We read some texts from the Jewish tradition, Tversky and Rabbi Shapira, who are asking questions about education, appealing back to Maimonides, and a sense of the knowledge which comes through habituation.
In Maimonides, the pedagogical teaching is that ideas can be encased or embodied in practices. The behavior will unpack its meaning and its significance through the repetition, through the habituation.
Professor Snell's a Christian and a philosophy teacher, and Rabbi Gottlieb is a rabbi, and it's very interesting when you have dialogue between them.
I see myself primarily as a Jewish educator who is trying to create opportunities for students to engage with the largest, deepest, most profound questions of human nature.
I spent 15 years of my life teaching philosophy in small Christian liberal arts colleges. One of the things I learned from the Jesuits was that the intellectual life and the life of faith had no tension with each other. And I felt that was the first time I'd had real permission to live a human life and a religious life at the same time. Tikva seems to have a genuine confidence that Judaism has something to say, that it has a truth, that it doesn't need to be ashamed or embarrassed of its own claims, but that those claims are robust enough to be able to engage with other conversation partners.
And having the Jewish piece there really drives it home, and it helps make it that it's something about your life, and it not only is in this philosophical, physical realm, like, you know, like above your head in the clouds.
That gives, I think, strength to our work. It gives a sense of confidence, it gives a sense of vitality, a lived experience.
Smith says, no, religion is not a unique conversation stopper. If you say religion's off the table, those who reject religion or push it off the table, they're also conversation stoppers. In fact, maybe more conversation stoppers, because they're refusing to even allow one form of discourse.
I typically thought of religion and logical thinking as sometimes in contrast with each other, but I think it's incredibly important to think about how being reasonable and thinking logically can be applied in a religious and Jewish life.
I don't necessarily get that challenging philosophy piece from my regular life, or just the ability to have discussions that are as great.
Our seminar gives, I think, the students a real way of looking at morality and faith and beauty as things that belong at the seminar table at a university.
Does human reason mean that you have to live a religious life or a life of morals as if it's non-reasonable, but just something that you're committed to or have a leap of faith into? That's the question.